Disculpe, estoy buscando desde el librero.
¡Sigue! ¡Sigue! ¡Capitán Nemo! El mundo no precisa de nuevos continentes, sino de hombres nuevos.
Beneficio reprochado, ofensa hecha. Uno para todos y todos para uno.
La bravura siempre es respetada, incluso en un enemigo.
¡Sigue! ¡Ale, ale!
Gracias, D'Artagnan.
Nada era del individuo, a no ser unos cuantos centímetros cúbicos dentro de su cráneo. El gran hermano es la concreción de que el partido se presenta al mundo. Su función es actuar como punta de mira para todo. ¡Sigue ahora que puedes!
Divide tu día en partes y a cada una asígnale una tarea, sin dejar un cuarto de hora, 10 minutos, ni 5 siquiera sin algo que hacer. Cuando sea así, observarás que no necesitas compañía, conversación ni simpatía de nadie, y lograrás vivir con la independencia que todo ser humano debe aspirar. Gracias, señorita Jane Eyre.
Sigue leyendo, sigue escuchando. Esto es Desde el Librero, un podcast de Librerías Gandhi. Bienvenidos, queridos lectores.
Queridos lectores, ¿cómo están? Yo soy Yara Vidal. Bienvenidos a este programa donde, para los jóvenes que leen a Victoria Schwab, a B.E. Schwab, pues han de estar ultra emocionados de saber que platicamos con ella, que Mercedes Alvarado habló con ella sobre una nueva trilogía que se lanzó a finales del año pasado, Los Frágiles y Los de Poder, en ediciones Urano, y en el cual retoma el universo de la serie Sombras de Magia, que se hizo entre el 2015 y el 2017, y presenta nuevos personajes, mismos escenarios y renovadas batallas del poder de la magia y de los gobernantes en tres Londres que han sobrevivido paralelamente. Ella, esta escritora estadounidense, es considerada una de las mejores plumas contemporáneas de ciencia ficción, cuyas obras además han sido traducidas a más de 20 idiomas. Conversó con nosotros, con Mercedes Alvarado, y este es el resultado de esa plática. Como fue una plática un poquito breve, porque andábamos en las carreras, les traemos además otro autor de thriller. En este caso es como un thriller medio eroticón, para el otro perfil de lector, por supuesto. Y el autor se llama Patrick Morgan. Patrick también es estadounidense y le preguntamos a Alejandra Alvarado, que es una autora también de Planeta, que le hiciera unas preguntitas para conocerlo mejor también como autor, sus gustos, sus últimas 5 novelas y sus libros. Los pueden encontrar en gandhi.com.mx en este momento de manera digital. Pero para que vayan abriendo patito, además, Patrick es, digo, o sea, no te voy a hablar yo mal nunca de un autor, pero hay autores que muestran a veces más fácilmente su corazoncito, las tribulaciones que luego pasan para llegar a escribir ciertas cosas, y a mí me gusta mucho cuando bajan ese muro, ¿no? De como de perfección. Entonces me encanta la plática que Alejandra logró desarrollar con Patrick, y además también pues le lo pedí a Ale porque pues son amigos y entre amigos salen las cosas de una manera a veces más linda para platicar sobre nuestros procesos creativos. Traemos, por supuesto, Horrores de Redactores por parte de Mariana Aguilar. Y en lecturas de película, bueno, pues es sorpresita porque es de los la parte que de las que más nos escriben, que les encantan los sketches que hacemos. Entonces les dejo la sorpresita tanto de Mariana como de lecturas de película. Y además de todo eso, Gilberto Díaz nos va a relatar qué es lo que les traemos en la revista de mayo, que ya pueden encontrar en gandhi.com.mx y pueden comprarla en línea y físicamente. Pues como cubrimos de Tijuana a Cancún, Espérense unos 2-3 días más para poder encontrar la revista. Yo creo que la próxima semana ya la pueden encontrar en su Gandhi preferida. Tratamos de correr, ahí sí me debo de confesar, tratamos de correr, pero luego hay días feriados y el fin de semana se atraviesa y las entregas y la distribución de la revista se nos atora un poquitito los primeros 5 días del mes, pero no se nos desesperen. Espérense a la segunda semana para comprarla, para que no vayan en vano, pero recuerden que la pueden pedir en gandhi.com.mx y te llega directamente con tu compra, con tu libro, por 25 pesitos. Y además en gandhi.com.mx pueden comprar ediciones anteriores. Si quieren otro de marzo, porque les gustó mucho la de aniversario, que por cierto es el número que más hemos vendido, y estamos muy contentos también porque traía una doble portada y son los 15 años, pero me emociona siempre como de saber qué es lo que les ha agradado y seguir también empujando hacia nuevas ediciones que les pueda hacer de su agrado. Pero les va a gustar mucho el número de este mes. Ya verán, es una mezcla de Fight Club, por ahí lo voy a dejar, sobre introvertidos y extrovertidos. Ya escucharán ahorita de qué va. Y recuerden que las entrevistas las pueden ver y escuchar en nuestro canal de YouTube con subtítulos para que no se sientan relegados las personas que pues no quieren escucharla totalmente en inglés y tienen el apoyo del subtitulaje en español. Y como siempre, agradecerles su lectura, su paciencia y el tiempo que comparten con nosotros. Comenzamos.
Desde el librero presenta Horrores de redactores. Todos los días, las y los hablantes modificamos la lengua española. Nacen nuevas palabras todo el tiempo, de las cuales algunas prosperan y se asientan en el uso y otras no. Hoy, en Horrores de Redactores, vamos a introducirnos en los procesos de formación de palabras. Existen dos caminos principales que recorremos para crear un nuevo término: la derivación y la composición. La derivación es el procedimiento de formación de palabras por medio de afijos, es decir, por medio de esas pequeñas partículas que se le agregan a la raíz de una palabra para modificar su significado. Por ejemplo, del verbo llamar se deriva el sustantivo llamada, pues se le agrega el sufijo -ada. La lengua española es tan, pero tan flexible que podemos derivar distintas clases de palabras de otras. Por ejemplo, un sustantivo, juramento, de un verbo, jurar. Un sustantivo, canallada, de un adjetivo, canalla. También podemos derivar un adjetivo, deportivo, de un sustantivo, deporte. O un adjetivo de un verbo, trabajador, de trabajar. O hablante, de hablar. Incluso hay verbos que provienen de sustantivos, como peinar, que se origina a partir de peine. Para acabar pronto, cuando empleamos afijos distintos a una raíz, tenemos palabras derivadas. El otro proceso de creación de palabras se llama composición y ocurre cuando dos o más palabras forman una tercera, a la que llamaremos palabra compuesta. Entre otros ejemplos está lavarropas, sabelotodo, agridulce o maxilofacial. Hay una palabra compuesta que descubrí en una tira de Mafalda. Para decir que Susanita era muy chismosa, la llamaban correveidile. Otra palabra compuesta aparece en la película de Oscar el Espantatiburones, además de la que viene en su título, claro. A los peces que trabajan limpiando la lengua de las ballenas se les llama raspalenguas. La diferencia entre los dos caminos para crear palabras, la derivación y la composición, estriba en que en la derivación hay una sola raíz con diferentes elementos agregados. En la composición, en cambio, hay dos o más raíces que se unen. ¿Pero sabías que existen casos en los que una palabra se crea a partir de los dos procedimientos combinados? Esto sucede en un adjetivo que seguramente has escuchado mucho últimamente: nada que veriento. Aunque aún no está integrado en ningún diccionario, investigamos en internet los significados que se le atribuyen a nada que veriento, adjetivo que se le aplica a una persona o a un objeto que no tiene importancia, o a alguien que se entromete en una situación en la que no figura. Esta palabra proviene de la composición de la frase nada que ver, que expresa una situación fuera de lugar, y de la derivación, pues se le agrega el sufijo iento o ienta, que indica estado o condición. Sigue escuchando Desde el Librero y cuéntanos qué otras palabras nuevas has escuchado y cuál crees que es su proceso de formación, la derivación o la composición. Y nos vemos en los próximos Horrores de Redactores.
Y ahora, la entrevista con
Victoria Schwab. Si deseas ver la entrevista con subtítulos en español, la puedes encontrar en el canal de YouTube Revista Lee Más de Librerías Gandhi.
So, Victoria, thank you very much for chatting with us.
It's my pleasure.
I read The Fragile Strength of Power. I know you spend a lot of time on that book, not only writing it, but thinking about it.
Yes. Yeah, I don't enter into anything lightly. And so when I finished the first trilogy, I didn't want to go back to the world unless I had a really strong plan. And for me, what a plan is that I need to have a set of accomplishments that I want to achieve. And so, yes, it took about 3-4 years to think of how I wanted to handle Threads of Power versus Shades of Magic, because Shades of Magic is the first series, Threads of Power is the second one. But I didn't want it to be all new cast, and I didn't want it to be simply a continuation of books 1, 2, and 3. I needed it to feel necessary. I needed it to feel important. And so for that, I stepped forward 7 years so that we could see the way that the people and the world had changed in the aftermath of Conjuring of Light. And I wanted to introduce a new arc, a new era, and a new challenge to the story, a new big bad, a new villain, a new all of these things. And so it took several years for all of that to come together. And then it took about 2 years to write what would become Threads of Power.
It makes all the sense in the world because the book starts with a phrase about growing up. People think growing up is important.
Yeah.
Yet.
Yeah.
And that's how it starts. So you're talking about you had to grow yourself and grow the story inside yourself.
Yeah.
And start a book with this phrase.
I mean, I think a lot about growth, especially as an author, as a creative, because every story that you write, you want it to be a form of growth. And growth isn't linear. Growth isn't bad to good. It isn't low to high. It's like organic. It's an expansion in every direction. And so I think a lot about growth as it relates to storytelling. This has grown. If you think about it from a technical perspective, there are like 4 perspectives and only this much story in A Darker Shade of Magic. And now it has grown with each and every book because the world grows and the characters grow and our investment in the characters grows as well.
But you also made the past grow in this story because past is very important here. This is something you didn't do with the other books. But now you're growing the story into the past.
I think one of the reasons I wanted to start 7 years ahead was so that we could have this sense of a fresh start, of a new door opening. But it meant there was 7 years of story, 7 years of past that was very important to the narrative. And so I think a lot about the difference between chronological storytelling and narrative storytelling. Chronological storytelling is the order in which the events happen. Narrative storytelling is the order in which I tell them to you.
And also...
Okay.
You also gave the space to tell us a story about the past of each of the characters.
Yeah.
How was it for Castilla when she was a kid or for Nadia?
Yeah.
How was it to swim into their childhood?
I love it because it's work that I would do anyway as the writer. I think that who we are is such a product of who we've been and of what's happened to us. And kind of one of the theses of the series is that like all of the things that we do, how we trust, how we fear, how we fight, are a product of things that have happened to us before. So things which happened in our past inform who we are now. Things which happened in Lila Bard's past have shaped Delilah Bard. Things that happened in Tess and Kosica's past, this is why they are the people that they are and why they're the people that they're becoming. And so I think that the past is such an integral part of storytelling because it's what makes us care.
It also shapes the society. That's why you wanted to tell us how it was the tree of the different Londons in the past, right?
Yes, I mean, it's creating like this series, both series start 200 years after this cataclysmic event. We never are in the past all the way to the cataclysmic event, but we've been inching backward towards it.
And now 7 years later, the other worlds or the other Londons are considered to be a problem.
Yes.
In many different ways, but it's always a problem.
Yeah.
Do you think that's how we are perceiving different states nowadays?
I think there's always insider-outsider culture. And we will always, when there are problems, we will always look to outsiders. We will always look to blame people outside of our system, our family, our society, our world. And so I think it's natural that red London looks to blame white London. White London looks to blame red. White looks to blame black London and gray London. Like, we are looking for problems elsewhere because the alternative is that we have to look at the problems within. We have to see responsibility within our society as well. And the fact is that, like, even though these worlds are cut off from each other for now, they weren't cut off for each other. Yeah. They weren't cut off in the past. And so it's really important to understand also the shifting boundary of place, that what was inside is now outside, that what was part of our world is now away from our world. And so we act as if these boundaries have always been there, but they haven't. Boundaries are something that we make.
And they're moving all the time.
Yeah. Or getting stronger or weaker or, you know, in danger.
I like that. You're saying, I'm going to quote.
Okay.
Taking the throne is cheap. Repairing the world, it's quite expensive.
Yes.
Tell me about that.
I mean, this is a thing in white London, especially traditionally in white London, the throne has been taken by force. Whoever has the most power takes the throne and holds it until somebody with more power comes along and takes away from them. It's a very simplified system. Mm-hmm. And what Kosica is discovering is that there's a difference between taking the throne and using the throne, earning the throne, like wielding the throne to make the world better. That is a ruler's job. That is a ruler's imperative. That is something, there are a lot of kings and queens in these books, and that is something that they all have to face, which is that they are existing from a position of power. What do they do with that power? Do they use it to make themselves stronger, or do they use it to make their society stronger?
I wanted to talk to you about the motivations, the triggers for each one of these girls.
Yes.
Because they are learning all the time how to challenge the rules, not bending them.
Yeah.
Challenge the rules. And their position is quite different. They come from different backgrounds. Mm-hmm. How did you picture these three so different girls?
Yeah.
And connect them?
I mean, I think it's really interesting that even though these are very adult books, the two new leads are teenage girls. And I think it's because that these teenage girls have power in different forms. Tess has the ability to bend the rules of magic in her world, but she's a runaway. Kosica is queen. And she has one of the most powerful magics that the world can have. And yet both of them, because they're teenage girls, are seen as objects, not subjects, to other people. Other people, adults, the people around them, want to wield their power as if it's their own. They're in danger of being used by everyone around them. And these two girls are learning how to resist the forces that would disempower them and take their magic and use it for their own behalf. And these two girls are learning essentially how to say no. These two girls are learning how to stand up for themselves. Yes, exactly. And that's a thing that I think, whether you're talking about contemporary fiction set in here and now with no magic, or these stories, that is something that all teenage girls specifically have to fight for, which is the right to their own autonomy, the right to their own fate, their own decisions, their own power.
There's something I really like, is that you're making them very, very human. Mm-hmm. But there's not always like, oh, I'm a good person all the time. And I have a character that is mean all the time.
No.
They have human motivations. They are taking decisions upon their families and the people they love.
I mean, I don't believe that. The thing is, I want to write characters that feel like people. And the difference between characters and people is that characters only exist in the book and people exist everywhere. And I want you to believe that they're people, not characters. And the thing about people is that we don't exist in black and white. We don't exist in good and evil. We don't exist at the far edges of those poles. We exist somewhere in the middle. We are not good or bad. We are messy. We are sometimes selfish and sometimes selfless. We have people that we love and would sacrifice ourselves for, and we have people that we don't. And I think that historically what we see in fiction, especially with young women, is this thing that when you give them power, you must also make them self-sacrificing. You must also make them willing to give away everything for the greater good. Why?
Were you thinking about Queen Elizabeth?
No, I mean, I think I was thinking about every girl that I have ever read in fiction or known in reality, which is who is expected to make themselves smaller so that other people can be large.
So we have seen it again and again and again.
Yeah, it's constant. It is a continuous recurring theme. And I think looking at those themes is what makes storytelling timeless.
Here's another quote. Houses as lives can be revealed.
Yes.
Are we going to reveal the story if we have more and more characters who are ready to manage power?
I mean, that's what you have to continue reading to see. There's definitely several forms of rebuilding that are happening in the books, but there's also a lot of destruction. And the argument by some of the destroyers is that things have to be torn down to be rebuilt, right? There is always a period of chaos before a new sense of order. The thing, though, is that there's people in the book who don't want the chaos, who want to maintain the order that is there, and there's people that want to destroy the order that is there in an effort for a new order, in an effort for a new era, a new age. And so I think we're going to see a lot of destruction as well as a lot of attempts at creating. And I think that healing is part of that, mending is part of that, but so is damage.
We'll have to read that.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Si deseas ver la entrevista con subtítulos en español, la puedes encontrar en el canal de YouTube Revista Lee Más de Librerías Gandhi.
Lee Más es la revista oficial de Librerías Gandhi, la cual la puedes adquirir en todas nuestras librerías a nivel nacional. No te olvides además que si ese mes se te fue comprar un número o quieres otro ejemplar, puedes ingresar en revistalemás.mx o gandhi.com.mx para adquirir los números anteriores por 25 pesitos.
Desde tiempos inmemoriales, la humanidad ha tratado de clasificar las personalidades. El médico griego Hipócrates ya dividía los temperamentos en cuatro tipos, y esta tendencia ha continuado a lo largo de la historia. Por ejemplo, en 1913, Carl Gustav Jung mencionó por primera vez la clasificación introversión y extroversión como parte de su tipología de la personalidad. En Lee Más estábamos intrigados por la forma en la que estos rasgos podrían hablarnos acerca de los escritores y artistas. Nos preguntamos si el hecho de que sean introvertidos, extrovertidos o ambivertidos se relaciona con las increíbles obras que pueden crear. Descubrimos que la enorme vida interior de los primeros resulta tan valiosa en la creación como las aventuras en el mundo real de los segundos, además de que hay un grupo, los ambivertidos, que pueden tomar lo mejor de ambos polos. En este número, Jaime Mesa y Adriana Romero Nieto nos recuerdan una gran lista de autores de cada bando. También tuvimos una charla con el grupo de autoayuda de dibujo que nos hizo pensar en el tema de las personalidades desde la ilustración. Armamos un test para ayudarte a descubrir si tu personalidad va más con Emily Dickinson, Ernest Hemingway u Oscar Wilde. Gilberto Díaz nos preparó un perfil del escritor Philip Roth, mientras que Sergio Tellespón abordó la mítica introversión de Marlon Brando. Las novedades artísticas y literarias no podían faltar en nuestras entrevistas del mes, que fueron sobre la Bienal FEMSA, la edición de No Give Up Man, de Libros UNAM, y el éxito de Todos Somos Villanos, de la autora M. L. Río. Finalmente, conseguimos para ti un adelanto del nuevo libro de Alice Oseman. ¡Gracias por leernos! Consigue este número en librerías Gandhi, gandhi.com.mx y revistalemas.mx. Y esperamos que este viaje por los secretos de la personalidad que se esconde en las grandes mentes creativas te haga pensar, reír, abrir conversaciones y buscar nuevas y emocionantes lecturas.
De las páginas del libro, directo a tu pantalla, te presentamos los clásicos de la literatura que han sido adaptados al séptimo arte.
Quédate en
Lecturas de Película.
Lo mejor de dos mundos llegó a nuestro podcast en esta sección de Lecturas de Película, donde juntamos el quinto y el séptimo arte. En esta ocasión, venimos a hablar de Kubrick en la literatura, para explorar el lenguaje cinematográfico del icónico director Stanley Kubrick. Era Lo, sencillamente Lo, por la mañana, cuando estaba derecha, con su 1.48 de estatura, sobre un pie enfundado en un calcetín. Era Lola cuando llevaba puestos los pantalones. Era Dolly en la escuela. Era Dolores cuando firmaba. pero en mis brazos fue siempre Lolita. Lolita, una historia controversial desde su publicación en 1955. Es la adaptación cinematográfica de la novela del mismo nombre escrita por Vladimir Nabokov. La película de Kubrick nos sumerge en la vida de Humbert Humbert, un hombre obsesionado con una joven llamada Lolita. Aunque la censura de la época limitó la exploración completa de la trama, Kubrick logró capturar la esencia de la obra original, manteniendo su intriga y complejidad de la psicología, los sentimientos y deseos prohibidos de este hombre.
It's partly my fault. I realize that is something that's happened on account of this horrible place. All these people poking their nose into our business, and I never see you anymore, what with your soda fountains and your extra... Stop doing that! But we could leave this place, perhaps. Look, don't you want to get back to where we were before we came to this horrible place? Don't you want to come away with me?
No! I hate you! I hate you!
Later.
Barry Lyndon es una película basada en la novela Las Memorias de Barry Lyndon, escrita por William Makepeace Thackeray. Kubrick nos lleva al siglo XVIII, a través de los altos y bajos de Redmond Barry, un joven irlandés que busca la fortuna y el estatus de la sociedad británica. La película de Kubrick es visualmente impresionante, capturando la esencia de la época y la intriga de la novela de Thackeray. Kubrick demuestra su habilidad única para recrear mundos históricos con un detalle asombroso, convirtiendo a Barry Lyndon en una obra maestra atemporal.
I'm Captain Feeney.
Captain Feeney.
Captain Feeney, at your service. May I introduce you to my son, Seamus?
How do you do?
How do you do?
My name's Redmond Barry.
How do you do, Mr. Barry? And now I'm afraid we must get on to the more regrettable stage of our brief acquaintance. Turn around and keep your hands high above your head, please.
Continuamos con 2001, una odisea del espacio. Una colaboración entre Kubrick y el aclamado autor de ciencia ficción Arthur C. Clarke. La película se basa en la novela del mismo nombre de Clarke. La obra literaria y la película exploran la evolución de la humanidad, desde sus orígenes hasta un posible futuro en el espacio. Kubrick y Clarke nos sumergen en un viaje visual y conceptual a través del cosmos, dejando al público maravillado y reflexionando sobre el significado de la existencia. La colaboración entre Kubrick y Clarke dio como resultado una obra maestra que desafía las convenciones y continúa inspirando a generaciones de espectadores y lectores por igual.
Do you read me, Hal?
I read you.
Open the pod bay doors, Hal.
I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
What's the problem?
I think you know what the problem is just as well as I do.
What are you talking about, Hal?
This mission is too important for me to allow you to jeopardize it.
I don't know what you're talking about, Hal.
I know that you and Frank were planning to disconnect me, and I'm afraid that's something I cannot allow to happen.
La Naranja Mecánica es una adaptación de la novela distópica de Anthony Burgess. Es una mirada aterradora a la violencia y la libre voluntad. Kubrick nos transporta a un futuro sombrío donde la delincuencia juvenil está desenfrenada. La obra original de Burgess es una exploración más profunda de la psique humana, algo que Kubrick logra transmitir con maestría en la pantalla. A través de la película, Kubrick nos enfrenta a preguntas sobre el libre albedrío, la moralidad y el condicionamiento social, haciendo que la audiencia cuestione su propia percepción de la justicia y la libertad.
Each of these slides needs a reply from one of the people in the picture. You tell me what you think the person would say. All right.
Righty right.
Isn't the plumage beautiful?
I just say what the other person would say.
Yes. Oh yes, well don't think about it too long. Just say the first thing that pops into your mind.
Cabbages. Knickers. It's not got a beak.
Good. The boy you always quarreled with is seriously ill?
My mind is a blank. And I'll smash your face for you, your blockos.
Good.
Continuamos con El Resplandor, basada en la novela de Stephen King. Kubrick nos sumerge en la claustrofobia y el horror mientras una familia se desmorona en un aislado hotel embrujado. Aunque la película de Kubrick difiere en algunos aspectos de la novela de King, logra capturar la esencia del aislamiento y la locura que se encuentra en la obra original. El Resplandor es un ejemplo magistral de cómo Kubrick transforma el terror en una experiencia cinematográfica inolvidable, manteniendo viva la esencia de la novela de King.
¿Has pensado qué sucedería a mi futuro si fuera a fallar y vivir up to mis responsabilidades? ¿Has pensado qué sucedería a ti? ¿Has pensado?
Stay away from me. Why? I just want to go back to my room.
Why?
I'm very confused. I just need a chance to think things over.
You've had your whole fucking life to think things over. What good's a few minutes more gonna do you now?
Stay away from me. Please.
Concluimos nuestro viaje con Nacido para Matar, basada en la novela The Short Timers, de Gustav Hasford. Kubrick nos lleva al infierno de la guerra de Vietnam, explorando la deshumanización de los soldados y la locura de la guerra. La película es un retrato crudo y poderoso de la naturaleza humana en un entorno despiadado. A través de su adaptación, Kubrick nos lleva a un viaje emocional y psicológico, dejando una impresión en la audiencia.
Everybody turned up got shot. Some they buried alive.
Ready? Colonel?
Marine, what is that button on your body armor?
A peace symbol, sir.
Where'd you get it?
I don't remember, sir.
What is that you've got written on your helmet?
Born to kill, sir.
You write born to kill on your helmet and you wear a peace button. What's that supposed to be, some kind of sick joke?
No, sir.
What is it supposed to mean?
I don't know, sir.
You don't know very much, do you?
No, sir.
You better get your head and your ass wired together, or I will take a giant shit on you.
Yes, sir.
Now answer my question, or you'll be standing tall before the man. We are here to help the Vietnamese, because inside every gook, there is an American trying to get out. It's a hardball world, son. We've got to try to keep our heads until this peace craze blows over.
Aye, aye, sir.
¿Y tú? ¿Cuántas de estas joyas adaptadas por Kubrick has visto o leído?
Patrick Morgan. Si deseas ver la entrevista con subtítulos en español, la puedes encontrar en el canal de YouTube Revista Lee Más de Librerías Gandhi.
Hola, buenas tardes, queridos lectores. Estoy aquí con el autor Patrick Morgan. Entonces vamos a platicar con él para que sepan un poquito más de datos sobre el autor. Él nació y vive en Estados Unidos, actualmente en Los Ángeles, y se graduó de la Universidad de Southern California y estudió teatro. Entonces él, su background tiene así como de actor. Nos va a platicar un poco más de eso al ratito y para ver cómo eso claramente influencia un poco en su escritura. Y su novela más reciente se llama It Will End in Disaster. Ha escrito 5 libros en total. Esta es su más reciente. Vamos a indagar un poquito más de cada una de ellas, que nos platique. So Patrick, thank you for being here for this interview. How are you feeling?
I'm feeling great. Thanks for having me. I feel like I picked up bits and pieces of that intro. I was definitely training my brain. I've been taking Duolingo Spanish. I'm about 2 days away from hitting my 500-day streak, so I still have a long way to go. But there were little bits and pieces that hopefully
one day we can do this in Spanish, right?
That's the goal. Maybe we can meet up a year from today or something like that and try and do it in Spanish, and then we can all get a good laugh at how bad my Spanish is.
No. I've heard you say a word or two, and you're good. You're getting better.
My pronunciation is getting better, and then I think that I'm getting better and better at being able to recognize it when I see it, like in writing form. Like if I see it on a bus stop or a billboard or an advertisement, then I can usually pick it up, or a commercial. But it's like hearing it, just because Spanish is spoken so quickly compared to English. Yeah. That's where I'm really still struggling. But practice.
Yeah. So, well, now that I've told everyone a little bit about you, now I think that I really want to talk about your writing in general. Like, can you tell us about your writing style, if you have one? Because I know sometimes people don't really like to stick to one. They just like to flow or express themselves, you know, according to the specific book they're writing. but like, what are the topics, the genres, like your writing style, so that people who are watching right now can really get to know you a bit more?
Sure. So I would say, generally speaking, I enjoy thrillers. That's kind of my go-to genre. Specifically within that realm of thrillers, I love psychological thrillers, anything that really kind of gets your mind turning, where from start to finish, you're wondering kind of the whole way along, like what exactly is happening here. Mystery, suspense. I also love elements of the supernatural and sort of fantastical, kind of trying to weave them in, not necessarily fantasy, you know, dragons and princesses and magic, but sort of weaving in, you know, elements of magic, or sort of what is going on exactly, that maybe there's some things happening. Because personally, I believe that there, you know, some things that we call supernatural or whatever. I mean, obviously, there are plenty of people on this planet who believe in ghosts or spirits or whatever it is, you know, kind of intuition. So I like to work in little elements of that kind of magical realism into my books as well. Like I said, most of them are psychological thrillers. I've definitely, you know, there are some that are different than others. Like, some are straight up psychological thrillers. One is more of a love story that has thrilling aspects to it. And then the most recent one, It Will End in Disaster, is definitely more an erotic thriller. Certainly psychological elements to that as well. But just generally speaking, I enjoy writing books that, like I said, kind of as a reader, you're constantly left guessing what's happening. I found as a reader, that's what keeps me the most engaged when I'm reading books or seeing films or TV shows, whatever it is. I like to constantly be wondering what is happening, because it keeps me engaged and enthralled as an audience member, as a reader.
Yeah, I just feel like you're very, having read all your books and enjoyed them, I feel like you're very like a mystical author in that sense. Yes. Like, you really tap into those things, and I really enjoy those things, because it's not, as you said, as like a complete like fantasy per se, but like you add like touches of like fantastical elements or mysterious elements, you know, magical elements into your stories, which are, you know, set in like the real world. So it's like a great mix where you get, you know, a little bit of both sides. And I really, really enjoy that. But like right now, I now want people to get to know more about your five books. We're going to dive a bit more into It Will End in Disaster later. So I'm going to do this little thing with you where I will show you a book and you have to tell me your elevator speech for that book, so people can know about it without, because I don't think we're going to have time to like go into like all five of them. And I really want to get to talk more about It Will End in Disaster, just because it's one of my favorites of yours. So, and your newest too. So, but I really want, you know, people to know more about the rest of your books. So we're going to start with Realms.
Realms. Awesome. I actually just used the word realm, I feel like, in my previous answer to your question. Yeah. Every time I say the word realm or realms, I think about this book. So this is, as I was just saying, I wrote one book that is a love story. And this is, and I think you use the word mystical. That's a great word for this word, or for this book. You can even see, just, you know, as based off the cover there, that it's definitely got a mystical vibe to it. Elevator pitch for this book would be love transcending parallel universes. And specifically, what would happen if you woke up one day and you found yourself in someone else's body and someone else's life, but you didn't feel like you belonged there? And then you met somebody else who you shouldn't know, but you feel this intrinsic sense of knowing, and perhaps even a deep-rooted love for that person. How would you proceed?
This is the first book I read of yours, and I was blown away. I have so many like amazing quotes in there that I feel this is like the most like quotey, you know, book of yours. Like, if that's a word or a thing, you know, sure. Like it's the, you know, the type of thing where I could like maybe print that quote and put it in like a poster or something, you know, like they're so good. Highly recommend. But now we're going to go with your first book.
Nice.
Parent Horizon.
I was going to say, it was fun. I kind of saw a sneak of one of them below, and then you changed it up at the last
second. Because I have my reasons. Yeah. So let's go with the Parent Horizon.
I trust you. No, it's a fun game for me to play too, to be like, which one is she going to pick up next?
Yeah, I'm keeping you in your toes.
I like it. Apparent Horizon, like you said, that was my first book that I ever wrote. Basically, elevator pitch for this book is, what would you do with tomorrow if there was no guarantee? Or I'm sorry, what would you do with today if there was no guarantee of tomorrow? So You know, without giving away too many spoilers, there's a suggestion that there might be this apocalyptic world-ending sort of cosmic event that happens at a certain time. And then there is indeed some signs that this event may have come to pass. And so the main character and his friend are basically left wondering, how are they going to spend the remaining days on the planet, potentially, not knowing how much time they have left. And at first, what kind of is a fun carpe diem, you know, maybe we'll go skydiving or whatever, quickly ventures into sort of the darker elements and exploration of humanity left unchecked with, you know, a world with no consequences. What are good people capable of doing?
Yeah, I remember reading this book when I was on a trip. And so I took it with me, like, and on the airplane, I was reading and I was so stressed the entire time, like in the best way possible, you know, because I do love thrillers, but I'm mostly like a romance reader. So the emotions that you get from each are so different, you know, and I was like, this is like, when I read a thriller, this is like, yes, I really love this, because like, I couldn't stop reading. Like I had to get, like, I was a second away of just going to the end and being like, tell me what's going to happen, you know? And like, I feel like that's amazing. Like, you did a great job at that. And also, like, something that's very interesting about this book, I have to say, is the fact that I maybe didn't like the main character a lot. Yeah. And that, yeah. And I know that that was intentional, because like, you were trying to portray this like darker side of humanity, as you very well said. So I felt for him, you know, but at the same time, it's like, dude, like he kept doing all these things that it was so hard to like I empathized with him, but it was so hard to like him. And it was a new experience for me, because usually like writers, they always want to make this like perfect characters who are like super likable. And like, for me, this was like, oh, you like, and being a writer myself, it's like, oh, so you don't, it works if you don't make them the most likable, you know, characters in the world, you know, because it serves a purpose for the story. So it was crazy ride, just seeing how all these characters started to, you know, go crazy. And I really loved it. I recommend it. You guys should read it.
Thanks, Sally. A quick thing just to say about what you were just mentioning.
Yeah, please.
You know, I mean, I just think of two popular TV shows in the past decade or so, Breaking Bad and Game of Thrones. Most people, I feel like, on the planet have probably seen one or both of those shows. And Breaking Bad, that, you know, protagonist, Walter White, does some pretty despicable things. I mean, he's a drug dealer. Yeah. He starts off with good intentions, wanting to, you know, make sure his family's taken care of when he finds out this terrible thing about being diagnosed with lung cancer. But eventually he breaks bad. It's in the title of the TV show. You find yourself being like, should I root for him or should I not? And it's the same thing with Game of Thrones. You know, a lot of those characters, I'm trying to be careful about spoilers and everything. You know,
yeah. It's a character development, right? It's the way they transform through the story, and they start a certain way. And it's like, they just like, just a change.
Right.
And it's amazing as a reader to catch that, to see that and experience that as you're reading. So I agree with what you're saying. Next, Hope's Last Refuge.
Jinx, we said it at the same time. yes, this book was written, full disclosure, in the midst of the pandemic. It's very much inspired by the global pandemic and COVID-19. Also was written not long after the George Floyd incident in the U.S., when there is a lot of protesting, a lot of, again, not this is all over, but sort of at the fever pitch or the boil of when there was a lot of socioeconomic and health turmoil. And it's elevator pitches. It's a post-apocalyptic thriller. It's a survival tale about a woman who is trying to live in this world that I say it's an alternate universe, but it very well, very easily, in my opinion, at least, could have been the world that we live in. We could have gone down that path a couple years ago. We still could go down that path. I hope we don't. But at the end of the day, it's also a love story. I would say, for me at least, right there along with It Will End in Disaster and Realms, that book is also very much for people who, it's kind of a sneaky love story, in my opinion. You know, Realms is very much, you know, that's how I advertise it. But this one, it's a gripping, harrowing tale of survival, and it's a thriller, but at its core is definitely a love story, you know, trying to triumph in a world of hate and, you know, fear and anxiety.
Yeah, I enjoyed this one so much. And reading it during that time, you know, it was still, you know, the pandemic was still, you know, on. It wasn't gone yet. So it was very, I don't know the word to use, but like enlightening to see like, oh my God, like things could have gone pretty badly, like in 2 seconds. And at the same time, I really love, because all the things that you're saying here, it's like basic human decency and how the world still lacks that. And so it was very, I don't know, it was amazing to see like an author caring about these topics and like doing it such a great way. And also the aspect of the love story, like I enjoyed it so much. I think I even told you when I was done reading this one that I needed more about them. Like I wanted to know more about their story, about like all the things that happened before this story started. I think it was, you made a great job at like setting like this great, solid, like strong characters. And these are the types of characters like different from others in your books where I was like 100% rooting for mm-hmm. her and mm-hmm. like, I need this to work out. Like I need, like she needs to survive. She needs to, you know, like I was, you know, all the time just like wanting the best for her. And So I really, really love that.
Thank you. Yeah, I agree.
So next we have one of my favorites too of yours, which is Bayaricum.
And I feel like I realized why you left this one for just before it will end in disaster, don't you?
Yep. You know exactly why. We're going to talk about this later, but
yes.
Why don't you tell us what this book is about?
Sure. So this was my third book that I wrote. It actually came before Hope's Last Refuge and then before my most recent one. This one's definitely a true blue psychological thriller. This one is about a young man who loses his job, finds out his wife is pregnant, ends up taking a job offer from a mysterious stranger he meets in a bar. And it kind of is a too good to be true situation where he goes to work for this tech company that seems like it's a paradise, but there's maybe more to that company and those individuals than meets the eye at first.
Paradise has a price, right?
The tagline, exactly. Definitely some sort of spooky cult vibes to this book.
Yeah, it was a very fun book to read. I really have some moments where I even laughed, and like just with the things that are said are like in a sarcastic, comical way. And I absolutely enjoyed that. And just the fact that it was like in moments where I was like, I don't know what's happening. Like, what's happening here? I need to figure this out, you know? And then you keep reading and it's like all these things start like coming up and you're like, oh my God, like, you know, and that ending, it's like, okay, like, you know, the type of ending where you're just gonna like toss a book and be like, can someone get me the author on the line, please? Like, you know, it was like an immediate need to be like, I was like, thank God I know Patrick and I can talk to him and ask him about it, but it's no use because Patrick doesn't say anything. So Patrick's the type of guy who you're going to ask him questions about his book and he's going to be like, you know, I feel like you love doing that. You love keeping people like guessing and like, because that's what you do. Like I finished reading this and I kept thinking about this for a few days. So I think that's amazing as a writer to get that, right?
It's what you just said, Allie, that I really kind of gravitate. I hope I'm not a sadist. You know, I'm not really just trying to go out there and make, although it is funny, you're not the first person who's said that they've had the impulse to or actually literally thrown the book across the room. Not just this book, but even some of my other books that I've read.
Yeah, 100%.
But, you know, what you just said in terms of you were still thinking about it for days afterward, that's what I want. That's what I, again, kind of going back to what I was saying earlier in this conversation, the kind of art that I gravitate towards, whether it's music or dance or visual art, you know, media, as far as books, film, TV, anything, is the stuff that sticks with you, the stuff that you keep thinking about. And it doesn't leave you easily because it really kind of resonated with you. And it keeps moving your brain and your heart and your soul, as corny as that might sound. That's the stuff that I enjoy the most. So I certainly enjoy resolving, hopefully, story arcs and character arcs and coming to a conclusion that makes sense to me, at least in terms of what I aim to set out as far as the story I'm telling in the book. But am I going to tie up every single loose end, perhaps? No, I don't
never. I don't think you're ever going to do that.
I just, because again, to me, and this is just me, obviously my opinion, but if you tie up every single end and everything is just kind of nicely put up with a little bow, as a reader, you take that, you file that away in your bookshelf. Yeah. Well, that was,
you're
good.
Done.
You go on with your life and you never think about it again necessarily.
Yeah, you're done with that and that's it. But yeah, I think that when you keep people guessing, and also, I don't know, it creates this, I think that's the beauty of reading, where you, where the writer gives you the chance to think about things, you know, to analyze, to create an opinion. And, you know, and it's also very easy to do this types of books for like book clubs, you know, where you can definitely, everyone like can start even fighting about like, no, you know, because I've had book clubs like that, where it's like, no, this is, you know, what happened. They're not, I believe this or that. And so it creates a lot of dialogue and a lot of very interesting things that, you know, as a writer, that, you know, that's the best thing ever. And as you said, when you're giving everything so easy, it's like, well, next. But then it's like, I think my sister read this too. Like I sent one to her, because we did a book club back then, because I was like, I need people to read this with me because Patrick won't tell me anything. So I need to make like 10 more people read this and give me their opinion so we can like, you know, sort this thing out. And I remember she, kept telling me like, that, you know, time has gone by. And she keeps remembering it, like, you know, like a year later, she's like, well, or then she starts talking about it, that then she doesn't even remember it was a book. Yeah. She's like, I saw this movie. And then it was like, oh, wait, no, that was a book. And that's amazing.
Awesome. Yeah.
Yeah. And awesome. Like she told me the other day, like she did that. She was like, she was recommending this movie or series to someone. And then she was like, oh, wait, no, that's actually a book. So for you to be able as a writer to create such vivid images in your readers that they, after a while goes by, they can't even remember it was a book. Like, you know, they created all these images in their head and they're confused about what they did. Like, I was like impressed by that. So I just wanted to let you know, I don't remember if I told you that story or not, but
that's awesome. Thank you.
Si deseas ver la entrevista con subtítulos en español, la puedes encontrar en el canal de YouTube Revista Lee Más de Librerías Gandhi.
Amigos, espero que haya sido de su agrado. Recuerden que están las 180 revistas, de hecho son más, 184 por ahí, que hemos hecho otros números que no contabilizamos por ser de niños, en revistalemas.mx, mascultura.mx, este podcast semanal, que ya tenemos más de 87 programas, y nuestras redes sociales, @revistalemas. Gracias por escucharnos, nos vemos la siguiente semana.